I'm seeing we are losing time, of course. So this is just a short talk about how to memorize. And I'm sure most of you know this, that we have a sensory memory, and we have short-term memory, and we have the long-term memory. And the important thing for musicians is going from the short-term and into long-term. And especially the procedural things that is to remember which procedure to use to make the strokes. And of course also the semantic, when we learn notes, when we learn pieces, that is important to go along with that. And we have a person called Jan Ginsburg, who tells about strategies for memorization. She talks about root memorization, that is when we practice things again and again until we do it automatically. Visual memorization, and you can do this in your score with color, pen, or anything that makes it more visual for you. And also memorizing by ear, of course. And I believe that it's best to try using more kinds of this memory. Some will be your favorite, we all different, but try to do it in different ways. Even Schick has a method in his book, it's on the literature list, you can get on the website. He says, practice maximum 7 notes. Read them first while playing, sing them afterwards, imagine the notes without looking at them, just play them in your memory, and then you play them by heart without the score. And then you go back, read it once again, blah 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 blah, continue this process until you're sure. Then you're using the oral memory, the visual memory, and the imagination at the same time. I take this kind of methods and use them on one piece and just see how it goes. I used it for one piece and I remember it so fine today. So you can use different pieces, will have different methods that are the best. But as students, just try methods. Say, okay, do this. You can try the thing you haven't mentioned about practicing backwards. Or Keiko Arbus uses a method of visual and oral combination. So she hears the sound and she has a picture of the marimba and it lines up the tone that she wants. That's another way you can practice music. And of course a lot of analytical methods. And I think important is here that you decide how to stabilize the piece. If you think that the piece is red, it's red. You just need to analyze it somehow so you get an opinion of what it's about. If you think it's C major and then G major, that is the picture of it. Then that's your picture. Understand? Just to get your own picture of it. So here's a short memory game. And you look at the first one, you close your eyes, say to yourself what the numbers are, and you continue like that down and see how it goes. And you go, nah. What we did there is called chucking. We found a pattern, like the ears, and something that was very easy to remember. So, when you practice things that is like numbers, normally you can remember 6, 7 numbers maybe. Don't practice more tone than that. But if you can chuck it like it's a fork, or it's a scale, or it's red, or anything that makes you feel like a unity, then you can remember more notes, and then you can have some more practice. So go for a chunking, but also realize how much can you actually remember, and don't do more than that. And I think if you remember 8 bars a day, you will remember about 3,000 bars in a year. That's quite a lot of pieces. So you don't need to remember hundreds of bars each day. Just take a small part of them. And here is a special event. So if you make special events of the music, make it something special for you, it gets more easy to remember. I'm sure you will remember this picture tonight when you go to sleep. So if this was some notes in your piece, you will also have to remember that. So, this is a typical Zen question. What does a flower know about being a flower? And we can take that a bit more broad to a modern world that says, what does a computer know about being a flower? And these strange questions can be used for understanding interpretation. The flower can say nothing about being a flower, but it's very good at being a flower. No one is better at being a flower than a flower. Because, okay, a computer can describe millions of things about a flower. You can go on the internet and just write what you want to know, and it will explain it to you. So it knows everything, but it will never be a flower. Okay, so we have two different things. So now you take one of the most interesting pieces you have, and you just imagine an inner journey to the essence of that piece. What is the flower of the piece? Mm-hmm. And we don't have time for that, actually, we can do it afterwards. After that, you go and analyze it, and you go finding out a million things about it. And then you actually find out both the computer way about the piece, but also go to the essence of the piece. And if you combine these two, you can find the meaning of the piece. Meaning is not created. The flower has no meaning about being a flower. It's just a flower. And the computer has no meaning about flowers. It's just giving you all the data. So to create art, you actually have to create a meaning by going in space. Here is an interpretation circle you can use. But an interesting part of it is, of course, the abstracts, the artist part of it, okay? We need the others as well. The pattern is the one that says you have to plan your practice, you have to have goals that you know you have to have way, you need to go somewhere with what you practice. That's the pattern, and he should come back all the time. He cannot get rid of you. Then you have the detective, the search for interesting things to work on, and says good questions about which chord is this, and things like that. The anthropologist looks for patterns and relations. What is the composer? Is he related to other composers? Does this way in which he makes the piece relate to something in other kind of art, whatever? And the artist that asks, what if this piece was seen as a chord? It's one chord that is actually evolving the whole piece. Anything you can imagine, this was just a bad example. But really ask the questions that are not normal band officer questions, okay? And miracles. In this way you should think like Disney. He said we want to make cartoon movies where the figures are moving like they were human and they should be in colors and they're talking to each other and all things like that. And no one believed him. He thought that was totally impossible, and look what Disney is today. Yes, so if you want to create special things, you have to look for miracles. Say, what would it be like if I could play my scales totally without mistakes? And you just go after that. It was actually a very fantastic movement. This is the community of practice. And it's a guy called Baker who did a lot of work in this. And it can be used in a lot of things. But from here, your community of practice is the school, your students, the origins, the society. Need to use each other, and in order to make a lot of joint sessions 2 times a week and have morning warm-up, we do physical stuff and things like that, and also a lot of channel music. And I do that because I think it's the way the students evolve most. If they're just by themselves in the practice room, it's kind of another world and they will not communicate so much. So this is a good way to go. What do you need to become part of this musical community of practice? Well, Mikhail told us, don't drink, exercise a lot. There's a lot of other things to say. I have the basic words here, commitment, imagination, subordination. So to be totally engaged, be at the time and things like that, and wanting to develop relations to each other. Imagination, be able to see it from the other point of view. Maybe this guy wants to play hard on that bar, and you don't like that. But you have to see, why does he think that? So you kind of be open to other people. Mm-hmm. So that's a way to use your imagination. Yeah, I also know that the unknown can be meaningful. If you hear a piece and you think, this bullshit, I really don't like it. Then go into it and find out, there must be some meaning somewhere. Subordination, If you are an orchestra that's a dictator or a conductor, and you have to subordinate. In general music, you cannot just play what you want yourself, you need to subordinate the other guys. And this is the work you need to do. Kind of being a bit humble with the way you are, so you're not the soloist all the time. You need to know how to do this kind of thing. And here we have another nice one. You see in the bottom is a mixer. And like you can show your balance in the sound with the bass and stuff like that, you should also be able to balance the way that you're learning. So you're both effective and creative. Okay, so these things are not, you can only do one or the other. It's a position that you can tune up or down, and you have to find the right balance between it when you practice. It can mean a lot of different things, and it's up to you actually to decide. Emergence, it's not like emergency. Emergence is what is coming by itself. So, like when we're practicing and everything is just fine and it has a flow and suddenly we just turn the beats like, if we had planned, I should practice this for 15 minutes and then I should stop and practice for 10 minutes. Then we wouldn't get what it came from the emergence. Okay? So, make room for that. And if you're planning everything all the time, maybe you should take a little one on this and work a bit more emergence work. Also, improvisation can be very useful for this. You just don't play notes all the time. Then we have identification and negotiation. That means your position. You have pieces you like, you love these pieces, you want to play them again and again. That is your identity. You should use that. I mean, that's important for you. That defines the person you are and the musician you are. So practice the pieces you love and practice them more and be super good at those. Negotiation is something else. That is what happens when you go to a teacher and says, no, you should practice more of this, blah, blah, blah. And then start this kind of, okay, I should do a bit of that. And that can make you grow, okay? So, you can do both. You can have your own identity, and you can take negotiations and you can grow. So, you be open for this. You can learn something from any teacher, no matter who it is. At least you can learn what you don't want to do. But you have to go into it and you have to really listen for what does it mean. Abstract and concrete. I think many persons in this festival I've heard talking about music have been very concrete. It means that you do like this, you do like this, you have this sound. I hear a lot of very concrete music making. What I love about music is when you have the abstract, the inner ideas, the artist of music. Evolving and being open to the world. And then you also have the concrete, that means you can play actually what is in your mind. There are some musicians that have beautiful minds and beautiful ideas, and they go on stage and they cannot play what they want to play, right? But there are also musicians that can play exactly what they want. They practice so much technique, no problems. But they didn't develop so much in the artistic way. Okay? So being at the conservatory is 30% technical on the handwork and 70% artistic work. Yes, that's a statement. I don't think all of you use enough time on artistic work. So go to art exhibitions, listen to a lot of music, make your artistic decisions. Be artist, not just someone who needs your hands. Okay? I mean, this is said in the very positive way, because I heard so many beautiful performances in this festival, and I really loved all of them. So just to tell you, go even more in this direction. See yourself as an artist, please. Yeah, let's go back to some concrete. How many of you did record the practice session? The whole session? Whoops. No. Okay, someone, great. Of course you can take the piece and then you listen, it's very useful. But actually, record the whole system and afterwards see what do I actually do? Is it getting better or is it getting better and then better again? Okay, so that's the concrete thing, is you're actually practicing the way that develops most. And you can also have a friend listening to you and give positive music afterwards. Find your own ways. We're still a young community of practice. Of course, there's a lot of great soloists in the world, but we're still a very young instrument, and you can find so many new ideas. So we are in the field of blue water innovation. That That means that we can find things that no one else did before. Don't play all the old pieces that was played in the beginning. I mean, it has developed. So find something new, something better. Okay? Some of the old pieces are totally wonderful. Continue playing them, but also go for new stuff. You can so easily go on YouTube and the internet. There's a lot of crap on YouTube, yes. But you can also actually just hear a lot of new things without any effort. Okay, so spend time here. Not on Facebook, on YouTube, okay? Yeah, and I hope they have fun, these guys, you should have as well. I mean, it's artist is not just being serious. You know Mozart, he's not very serious, but he's a great artist. So have fun. Make fun of each other, have fun when you practice. It doesn't have to be too serious always. I couldn't say anything I wanted to say today. So I will make some videos and post on my homepage about these subjects. I will try my best to say something more comprehensive than today, so you can maybe learn more also. Yes. Lots of questions. You're too tired. It's okay.